Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Suraj in Cloud. In this video, we are going to discuss endpoint slice. Few months back, when I updated my cluster to 119, I started seeing issues with the networky components like Xilium, Core DNS. And then when I looked at their errors, it was a very common error regarding the permissions to endpoint slice resource. And then I was wondering, what is this endpoint slice resource? Because till that point, I never came across the resource. Then I decided to dig more into it. So in this video, we are going to explain what is the endpoint slice resource, why it's there. But before we jump into that, let's set a context and let's go little in background to see how it works and why endpoint slice was introduced. So we all know that we use service resource to point to a set of pods. Like usually there will be a deployment which will be having a set of pods, and then we expose them via service. Now, we are not going into detail regarding the type of the service and stuff like that. We might cover that in some other video. Now, we also know that the service uses label selectors to point to a specific set of pod. As shown in this diagram, app prod means prod service will point to prod pods using the labels app equal to prod, and similar for staging, it will point to the staging pod with the help of app equal to staging label. But how it works behind the scene? So there is a something called endpoint resource, which holds the information about all this pod with those given labels and their IPs and port information. Same for staging and similar for production as well. So along with this label selector, there's this endpoint resource, which also plays a crucial role, which holds all this information. And then, and one more level down in the networking, how the components knows all this stuff. So the kubeproxy, which sits on every node, pulls these resources and gather all the information and keep it on the node and pass it on to the next networky components, such as IP tables. Okay, so now this endpoint thing plays a very crucial role. Some of you might not aware of this resource, because at most of the time we don't deal with endpoint resource directly because we have service resource. So endpoint resource looks something like this. It has the name similar to the service so that we know that they are associated. It holds the information such as IP address of the pod, where is the node name where that pod is running, and also the port information, like which port has been exposed. Now, you must be wondering the problem. The problem comes when we want to scale. Now, from the endpoint slash documentation, and some of the blog post and one of the KubeCon talk, I gathered some information which I'm going to showcase now. So as I said, scale, let's take this an example, a service which points to 5,000 pods, meaning a endpoint resource will hold information of 5,000 pods. Sorry. Now, to visualize the scale much more bigger, consider the 3000 node cluster. Now we have a service which is pointing to 5000 pods in a 3000 node Kubernetes cluster. Now, what next? Now, this endpoint resource, which is holding 5000 pod information, cost 1.5 MB of a space in etcd. Now, we can increase this in etcd, but it degrades the performance of etcd. So let's say if we keep the same and this endpoint object is holding information of this 5000 pod, right? Now, what if one network endpoint in this endpoint resource changes, means one pod changes? That means if we do a calculation, 1.5 MB, and we are transferring this information to 3000 node, that means for one single change, we will be having 4.5 GB of network data transfer. Sorry, data transfer over the network, right? Now, imagine one scale beyond. If we are having rolling update of a 5000 pod, that data transfer over the network goes beyond 22 TBs, which is equivalent of 5000 DVDs. So this is not really scalable. That's why Kubernetes community introduced this resource called Endpoint Slice. It was introduced in Kubernetes 1.16 as alpha, but from 1.19 it is enabled by default, and that's where the controllers which were consuming this resource started using them by default. And if you didn't have RBAC permission properly set for Endpoint Slice, you also must have seen that these controllers start to fail as you update. Now, as before, kubeproxy was looking for the service and the endpoint resource. Now onwards, Endpoint Slice will be the source of truth for kubeproxy, meaning kubeproxy will look watches for the endpoint slices. Now, let's take an example here how this endpoint slice will work. So let's say an endpoint is having an information about 9 pods. So this endpoint slice, what will happen is there will be 3 different endpoint slice, meaning 3 slices of endpoint which will hold the information of 3 pods each. Now, this is just the example, but the numbers will be much higher in practice. So now, if there is a change of one pod in which is a part of one endpoint slice, then in that case, we will only need to transfer that particular endpoint slice, which will be having significantly small size and which will be having significantly low data transfer over the network as well to all these nodes, right? Now, this is just an example, but by default, each endpoint slice will be having 100 endpoints in them, which you can configure using this flag called max endpoint per slice. You can configure this flag on a kubecontroller manager, right? And you can put value till 1000 on it, right? So now with this new approach, we can achieve 10 times more scalability because the data transfer of this resource has been dramatically reduced so that we can now do much more things faster. So going back to the example, we are having rolling update of a deployment which is having 5000 pods. There's no need of having 22 TBs of transfer. It can be done in like laser, maybe a GB or so. So just to give you a quick analogy, we can relate as this, like how deployment creates the replica set and then replica sets hold the information about pod. or maybe it controls the pods. Similarly, you can say service creates the endpoint slice, service endpoint slice, and then endpoint slice holds the information about endpoint. So now we know that it is helping us with scalability, but it is also offering us some other feature as well. So let's look at endpoint slice resource to get to know more about it. The first thing you can see, it mentions address type. That means it supports both IPv4 and IPv6 stack, meaning if you have a service which is pointing to some set of pod, now with the help of endpoint slice, you can have one endpoint slice which points to a set of pod which who are having IPv4, and another endpoint slice which is pointing to pod which are having IPv6. There is one more feature that endpoint slice is offering, is basically a condition which we will discuss later as well. It also showcases topology, that means on which node this endpoint is and which zone it is in. So to achieve, let's say, some sort of high availability and like much better reliability, you can rely on this information from this resource. And as I said earlier, the service is the owner of this resource, as you can see. As we mentioned, it's the dual stack. It supports both IPv4 and IPv6. And as I was discussing about the condition, so there are three types of condition in the endpoint slice, which is ready, serving, and terminating. So basically, depend on how pod is reacting, it keeps the state of that endpoint. Now, if you are writing any controller which consumes this resource, now to know about pod, you can just look for this field called ready, which will tell you whether the pod is ready, whether it is serving traffic, or whether it is terminating state. It's quite helpful. And I'm pretty sure the controllers, which does some networking things like Core DNS or maybe Cilium, must be utilizing this thing. Or if you are writing any of your own controller, you can utilize these fields as well. Nice. So that was the endpoint slice. It helped me. So this endpoint slice was a bit of a pain for me while we were doing the upgrade and the permission stuff, but then I decided to give it a read and like share with you as well whatever I learned. Hope you like this video, and if you have any suggestions and feedback, do let me know in the comment. And if you like this video, hit that like button and do subscribe the channel. Till then, goodbye.